Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Sloppy Lab. I'm JT Russell, and we thought General Order 24 was bad. The Jedi sure didn't like General Order 66. But oh mama, General Order 3457 is a doozy.
Yes, it is. I apologize to Star Wars fans listening to JT Russell. Everyone knows it's just called Order 66, not General Order 66.
Or the Order. I mean, you might just say the Order, I guess. I don't know. But then it's confusing. I don't know. It gets confusing.
I do appreciate General Order 3457, though. That's a really good one. Might be my favorite one yet.
Oh, okay. Right on, right on. Oh, and the chat asking you, Quick Draw, if you got a new camera or just a different angle.
Fudginator, I'm so glad you noticed. No, I did not. This is the same camera, but I built myself a nice little computer stand. So I have a proper angle from the camera to my face. It's ergonomically better, makes me look probably better on camera, as you've already noticed. So yeah, thanks Murph.
Yeah, and it comes with a free haircut? No, you know.
free haircut as well. Yes. This is and a free t-shirt as well. I mean, all kinds of new stuff this week in store in the Sloppy Lab. And there's going to be lots of new stuff shown after this as well. If you're normally a podcast listener, you're going to want to check out the Twitch VOD when this is over.
Okay.
And give it a watch. Although if you're just a podcast listener, by the time you get this, it might not actually be a big deal anyway. Who knows?
Well, we shall see. Some foreshadowing for sure. And to that end, we should probably also get out of the way that we're going to be talking about some Winds of Exchange cards, so there will be spoilery things here. If you're hoping to be spoiler-free at this point, then be warned. Be warned. They're coming. This is, though, a double-sided artifact episode. We haven't done one of these in a little bit, or maybe no, we have. Yeah, yes and no.
I think you usually wait till I leave to do them, even though this is my favorite recurring segment we have. I love the double-sided artifacts. We haven't done one in a while. I think Fudginator was a guest host the last time we did them.
Dry the River. Yeah, we did Dry the River with Murph. That was a lot of fun. I don't think we technically had one for Astron. We should make a point of having, or we did not, but we should make a point of having some double-sided artifacts for our guests. And I wouldn't mind doing Quixel Stone again at some point. Maybe
I wouldn't mind doing Whirlpool again at some point.
Who would you bring on for Whirlpool though?
I don't know anyone that likes Whirlpool. good one, Fudginator. I like that. Dry the River was definitely full of dry humor. I would agree with that. You know what we could do is have the Whirlpool Quixel Stone episode combined. Because those two together, I am looking for a Winds of Exchange deck with both of those together. You see one out there, let me know, because it's going to be amazing. And that's maybe a good way to revisit each of those cards.
Yeah, well, I know that, or I've heard rumors that Ned Mike, Mr. Quixel himself, got a Quixel Stone in a namesake deck that had Mr. Quixel in the name or something. Yeah, and that is
a true story.
That's a true story.
I think it actually said Quixel King.
Quixel King.
And it came with a Quixel Stone. So I should have put Whirlpool King in my game found.
I know. I was like, I should have put JT Russell, who gets lateral shift in every house or something like that. Yeah.
I wonder. That's such a coincidence to call it Quixel King and get a Quixel Stone.
You know.
I wonder if there's some algorithm things going on. I feel like someone did an analysis in the past about when your deck has this name in the title, you're more likely to get this card.
Mm.
And I wonder if Quixel or another word like that might be a similar thing.
Interesting. I've definitely noticed name card correlations, but that's also me looking at it in hindsight with lots of bias to be like, ooh, look, the name and the card, you know, for sure.
Definitely. Confirmation bias, I believe.
Yeah.
That's called.
Yes. Yeah, so the chat's saying Ned Mike would be great for Quixel Stone. 100% agree. We covered Quixel Stone, but I feel like I feel like with Winds of Exchange, there are some new facets to uncover. I'm actually, I think I mentioned this was before, but I'm actually considering for the upcoming Vault Tour a deck with Quixel Stone, primarily because of the interaction that Quixel Stone has with tokens. And this deck is not a Winds of Exchange deck. It has makes no tokens, but I like the idea of being able to play my own creatures while they make tokens, or just having no creatures. I'm like cool with either of those things. But anyway, that's for another day. Not for today. Not for today.
Well, no, but the token stuff, it does have it's kind of like flipped a lot of things on its head. You know, like the Quixel Stone is one example of a card that kind of just changes how it's played because of the existence of tokens. Whirlpool only slightly, but one of the cards we're going to talk about is an older card, and it completely changes like what you look for in this card now that Winds of Exchange is out compared to before. And we're talking about Autocannon. Did you ever in your life, before this set came out, seek out auto cannons? I don't know if anyone did.
I
It's
mean,
just like,
I sought out Autocannon plus Bad Penny plus Soul Snatcher.
right. I think everyone did, and I think I heard someone paid hundreds of dollars for one. There's very few of those that exist, but yeah, like that's a niche combo. For with Autocannon, that was like pretty much all it was good for prior to Winds of Exchange. And this one definitely counts as a double-sided artifact. One of the ones we're going to talk about later, we're going to kind of like do some loose interpretation of the double-sided artifact. But Autocannon, in my opinion, is completely changed. And it's now a card that I, in the right deck, will be seeking out. In the wrong deck, it could just be a terrible card that you would discard every single time because of tokens. But it's a card that you actually have to look for in decks now. If you're playing Winds of Exchange, and if you have something like, I don't know, a Trader, or maybe a Blorb, or possibly a Prospector, you know, you have to think about that. But it totally changes your game plan if you're seeing the autocannon on the opponent's list, which I don't think is something that we've ever had to think about before.
Yeah, I was thinking about this too. Would you be happy to see an autocannon when you've got Prospector as your token? I mean, I feel like I'm usually wanting to stockpile Prospectors and then have a big windfall or have a big kind of haymaker play as opposed to incremental advantage. Like,
I think it's going to depend on the Prospector deck. Like,
yeah.
Prospector is one of the best ways to get efficiency in Winds of Exchange. And I think if you're playing against a Prospector deck and you're not exactly sure of like how it usually likes to play with the Prospectors, what how it can take advantage of it, I could see a lot of players saying, "Dang, I got to discard this autocannon because every token generator becomes draw card," which sounds really bad, I think. It's not as bad though as having the ability to reap with all these prospectors and then draw cards anyway. Or like you said, the Big Bang play where you try to set up like six of them, destroy them all at once, draw a bunch of cards, have a big combo turn. I think that's where like the real meat of the prospectors is going to be in, is that like critical mass of prospectors where you just kill them all in one turn and then you have a big combo. So I do think Autocannon is a pretty good card if you're facing a Prospector deck, but it will totally change how you play that game.
Yeah, I tend to agree with you on that. I mean, I have a Prospector deck that looks very spicy, and it's totally of the, wanting to amass a whole bunch, mass buyout or Champions Challenge. It has a Legacy Champions Challenge. Is that Legacy? No, Champions Challenge.
I think it's just in the set.
Okay, so it's a different deck that has a Legacy Loot the Bodies alongside Champions Challenge, which is pretty fun. But I couldn't recall off the top of my head
That's
which is a
a
Legacy.
good legacy.
Yeah,
Yeah,
that's
that one's a
fun.
good one.
But yeah, it's like, you want the mass buyouts and the like, okay, I draw these cards, and then it's also got the not Wheel of Fortune, but Winds of Change counterpart, the one that you discard your hand and draw the same number. So not Punk, but Punk Light.
Yeah.
Punk Light.
I forget what it's called too, but
Yeah.
we'll learn these cards eventually.
And yeah, so really cool. But I think you mitigate the tokens, the Prospector specifically, at least from a lot of the big combo-y prospector decks that I've seen, by just kind of keeping them from getting a critical mass, and autocannon seems pretty good at doing that. I mean, Dataforge stream in this chat saying that, yeah, autocannon just completely wrecks some of the woe decks that are out there. Totally. I mean, any of the one power tokens are essentially kind of turned off. I mean, Prospector does a thing, but your bots, you know, your clerics, is it cleric or disciple? The capture
cleric,
one?
I think cleric is a one. Yeah. One capture one. Priest is a one. Raider is a one. They're like, a lot of them are just, you know, token generators are almost dead cards against autocannon. So in that regard, if you are relying on a one power token, you might also need to be packing some R if you can. And obviously you don't have the option. It's take it or leave it. But autocannon will make up for a lot of lack of C in Winds of Exchange. I think there is a pretty good amount of it, and there's a lot of fighting going on. I've played a few games with Winds of Exchange so far. There is definitely more fighting, which we're going to talk about a little bit later on the next card. Mm-hmm. But having the autocannon against stuff like the traders that just action steal one, it takes away a lot of your need to fight, which will open up your ability to reap a little bit more. So it's a really key card in the right matchups. But I would say against older decks, like not just Winds of Exchange, like you really have to think twice about, like, do I play this versus a Rad Penny or a Q-Mex or things like that? Like, I see a lot of players with Q-Mex especially just kill it immediately and just go for the draw. And this doesn't even, they don't even have to go out of their way to kill it anymore. You know, it would, so I think autocannon is still like a questionable play versus decks that spam Rad Penny and things like that. But other than that, the only things you're really looking for, like a Misery Exploit, if your opponent has that, that would be bad. A Darna, as someone mentioned, I think in chat, is another good one that you would look for if you have the auto and the auto cannon.
That one's tough though, as the auto cannon's coda, but not AOA. So we actually made use of Darna. So I think actually Zoc from Dataforge stream played in the ABR Jank Artifact Week, which is not this past ABR where you had to play 7+ artifacts, but one where you got to bring a double-sided artifact and have it permanently in play. Kind of outside of your deck, it was sort of the like commander-esque, right? Bring an artifact, it's always in play. And I want to say Zoc played, chose to bring an autocannon with like a quad Darna deck from AOA, and got to do some cool stuff there.
Yeah, I would have expected for that format to be a lot of the Bad Penny Soul Snatcher autocannon like you talked about.
There is some of that because you know you get to have either the autocannon or the Soul Snatcher. That format was an interesting one. There's some silliness that happened, but it was kind of a cool example of how you can challenge folks to kind of deep think into a format and see what's going to be good and what's not. And there was sort of a mini meta that kind of evolved. And I mean, I think we've talked about this from a couple angles, but the wide openness of Keyforge is so great because there's just a lot of viable options. But as soon as you constrict it a little bit, some of these better strategies tended to emerge, and folks were converging on some kind of clear archetypes in that game, in that kind of week. So it was interesting to see. Definitely a cool experiment. And a nice note from the chat too here that we should kind of mention, is worth mentioning. Autocannon specifically says that it does damage to the creature when it enters play as opposed to being played. Make sure I get the card correct.
Yeah, that's correct. And then Fudginator pulled it up. Deal one to each creature after it enters play. So that applies to tokens, and that applies to regular creatures. We talked about that wording recently too for Quixel Stone. And not to get too off topic, but Quixel Stone, the reason why you're talking about it and how it kind of changes how that artifact is played is that it still allows you to generate tokens even if you have more creatures on board than opponent. So it does let you get around it a little bit. And I think you were talking about playing it in a deck that is not a token deck, an older deck. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I don't want to get us too off topic, but yeah, it's just another example of like the wording of these enters play, which is what tokens will do. You will never play tokens.
Yeah, don't even jar them.
that would be a pretty big blunder. Once you're not on TCO, I wonder if TCO would even let you name it. Probably.
I mean, it's a card in the game. I'd be surprised if it wasn't in the prompt. I think it's a valid thing to name. I don't know why it would stop you. It would be a poor choice.
Something, yeah, something to look out for in real life play too, when there's not a computer that'll tell you, are you sure you want to end your turn right now? And you just say each jar prospector, and you're like, okay, carry on.
Question from the chat, if I can jar the tide. I know a lot of folks who would.
Murph, I can't believe Fudginator, DT best set of all people, was the person to ask that question.
I think Murph means they want to put the tide in a jar and take it with them close to their heart wherever they go.
Oh, I don't know about that. I hope so. Let's give them
Yeah,
benefit of the doubt. I'm going
totally.
to believe that. So, autocannon. You like to see it in your Winds of Exchange deck? Yay or nay?
I am happier to see it in Winds of Exchange, provided I have a well, now come all the caveats, right? Provided I don't have a one power token, and I'm also not sure that it really encourages fighting, right? Like, especially for effects that want my creatures to survive a fight. So if I'm playing, well, one of the other artifacts we're going to talk about later. If I'm going to be playing Ancient Battleground, I might not also want to have an autocannon if I'm intending to play that Ancient Battleground, because I not only want to be fighting, but I want my creatures to survive the fight. So if that one damage is going to start all of a sudden meaning a lot of my creatures die in their fights, I may be sad. I may be sad. Yeah, I mean, Winds of Exchange does have the Cleansing Wave-esque card that heals and then has each of the creatures that were healed capture. I'm blanking on
That's
the
right.
name.
It's Absolve, yeah.
Absolve. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm gonna
So
pull
not
up
as
here as
good
well.
as the Cleansing Wave, but Absolve does have a pip this time, whereas Cleansing Wave doesn't. And you heal one from each creature. Each damage healed captures one from its opponent. So, not bad. A little synergy with the autocannon. Nothing game breaking. So, I did
Interesting.
have a pretty sweet play earlier today with the Renewed Life, where you heal a creature and you make a token for each damage healed. And I was able to make eight traders at one time with it.
Eight traders. Eight traders or eight prospectors?
Traders, the ones that one power action steal one. So, when you're staring down a board of those, you know that you have to handle them quickly because they will take you off check at 11. Cool card though, but if autoencoder were out, it would have eliminated that entire play.
Yeah,
So.
it's definitely going to hose a whole bunch of decks. And I mean, yet to be seen if the decks that it hoses are ones that are really going to be what we're going to be watching out for the top tables or not.
I think Prospector.
I think Prospector for sure. I don't think the Berserkers terribly care a ton, other than that the rest of the suite, your Brodnar suite, probably also wants to be fighting. And whether or not those duders want to also be destroyed will maybe put in question. But we'll see.
Yeah,
We'll see.
I think what I've seen so far, I've opened a lot of Brobnar. I mean, that's like sort of a humble brag. I know everyone loves Brobnar in Winds of Exchange. I've opened an absurd amount of Brobnar. Of the 27 that I've opened, I think like 19 or 20 have been Brobnar. Like, it's just an absurd ratio. But it means that I've got to play a lot of Brobnar, and fighting is definitely a thing again, which is really awesome. And when I say it's a thing again, I mean, it's a thing for the first time since playtesting of Call of the Archons. It's like real. You actually want to fight, and it's really cool. I think it adds a lot to the game. We're seeing like deck composition in Winds of Exchange is a bit different. Like you noted that there's a lot fewer creatures in general because of the token generators, probably. I think there's a little bit less creature control actions. That's just anecdotal. I don't have any evidence of that yet, but it feels like that is the case for a lot of my decks, which in Winds of Exchange sealed encourages you to fight more. It's necessary, really. And so I've really enjoyed it. I think it's been an excellent sealed experience in Winds of Exchange, largely because you are fighting more than you would in previous sets.
No, totally. I mean, I guess the games that I've played have been somewhat colored by facing down Berserkers for my brother, which is the deck that he's most excited about right now. And actually, in our play by post games with Not Tonight, there's been a decent amount of fighting too. So, yeah, and I'd agree with you what you said. It does feel like there's an awful lot less action type cards that just deal with creatures, kind of sans downside or without kind of hoops to jump through. A lot less just sort of like, okay, wiping the board and moving on. There's sort of some hoops or there's some conditions. Yeah.
May have something to do with there being no Dis anymore. You don't have cards like Implosion, Gateway, yeah. Dance of Doom, all kinds of stuff that just destroys creatures. It's kind of not there anymore.
Yeah. So making it up with fighting and also, yeah, super happy to see fighting become more of a, I don't know, getting a little bit of a boost, a little bit of a push, if you will. Seems really good. I mean, I'm excited. I think it's always cool when, you know, one of the things that's pitched to you as one of the like fun and flavorful parts of a game also becomes, you know, top tier relevant. I mean, ostensibly top tier relevant, more so. I mean, there are definitely decks that I've wanted to fight before, and we did a whole episode on that too, but I think this kind of pushes it to a new level. So super excited. Question from the chat too. If by fighting we mean interaction with person across the table,
if you're playing your brother, yes,
that will go poorly for me.
Little brother beating up on the big brother.
Big little brother. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, speaking of fighting, we have a few other cards to get to that definitely involve fighting, and we'll talk first about Shattered Throne, which is making a comeback. It was in, I believe, just Worlds Collide. Is that right?
Just Worlds Collide. Yep.
Yeah. And it could have been, it's like a hint of like what could have been for Worlds Collide Brobnar. You know, like with a little bit more push, I think Worlds Collide Brobnar could have been like the fighting house that we're seeing now. Like it was pretty close. They just made a few minor missteps, I think. And if they could have encouraged the fighting like a Brick Nasty, I used to say that Coward's End, if Coward's End were in Worlds Collide Brobnar, it would have made the house playable. Because Worlds Collide just really lacks creature control. And Brobnar offers that, obviously. But it just felt like they took away Coward's End and they put in Volcano, which is just a straight downgrade. And had they added something like Brick Nasty at that time as well, it really could have like changed people's tunes about Brobnar and what it's able to do in Worlds Collide.
Yeah, I mean, I think you needed maybe one or two more cards that rewarded fighting on top of having one or two creatures, you know, non-NARP creatures that went over the top of the dinos. Because it's really tough to be kind of, you know, we're the fighty house, but like the dinos are bigger. So this is kind of awkward. And I mean, I will definitely make the argument that Worlds Collide Brobnar is underrated in general. I have a lot of Worlds Collide Brobnar decks that I enjoy.
Wow.
Yeah.
We need a hot take emoticon or something. I don't know. I've never heard anyone say that before.
Yeah. But I don't know. But I mean, 100% agree. I think the things that were missing there, it feels like they're kind of hitting their stride. And honestly, maybe knocked the Saurians down a peg or two. Didn't hurt.
Yeah.
Didn't hurt. The old Brobnar cause, you know?
Well, it could have helped, I think, for sure. But we have Shattered Throne now coming back, and I don't think very many people played with it at a competitive level before, just because it was in a house that you never wanted to play in a competitive level. But now a lot of people think Brobnar is the best house this set, which is pretty close. It certainly is close. You're going to see Shattered Throne a lot more, and it is double-sided, so if you're playing against it, don't forget to capture when you fight. Mm-hmm. It does provide some A in a set where I don't think there is like abundant A in this set. Brobnar has some pretty good amber control. Rant and Rive is the one that first comes to mind. But Shattered Throne giving you the ability to take them off check in any house, I think is pretty interesting. And it's something that you might actually have to look for if you don't have a lot of other amber control in your Winds of Exchange deck. But at the same time, you also have to be cognizant that they can do the same thing to you from playing this card. It might help you out and get you some amber control, but a savvy opponent's going to just be able to take that right back from you.
Yeah, totally. I've played Shattered Throne a little bit in the past. I don't have a, you know, an Archon contender type deck that I would you know, features Shadow Throne in a big way, but have played it in, you know, SazCap events or things like Moirai or Adaptive. And most of the time when you're using it, or when I've used it, it's to sort of stall and stall and then hopefully build up to some sort of a steal or punishment for when they reclaim that amber and then have a lot, you know. So you think, okay, I'm going to fight and capture and then reap, and then you finally kill my big dudes with lots of amber on them, and I've got the graft waiting. Or the deck that I've got pulled up on the stream right here is the Implacable Spirit Caller. It's coming at 60 Saz. It's a deck that I've played in, you know, SazCap events right around 60, which features Shattered Throne and Double Cutthroat Research. So, you know, loves to fight, loves to kind of push your opponent off the board, and then eventually, once they've dealt with your dudes, you've got the Cutthroat Researches available. And I think this is actually kind of, you know, also hinting at, or also hinting at where the Worlds Collide, or not, sorry, the Worlds Collide, the Winds of Exchange Brobnar gets to shine in the Amber Control world, because, you know, we don't even need two houses anymore. You can do the same thing but with Rant and Rive, which I'm super super jazzed about. So, you know, if you want to stop at six, that's fine, but at one fight and you're off check, and now I have an Amber sitting on my Brobnar dude, and either you go to six again, I fight again, or you burst up and I can go right back into that same house, maybe kill off my giant, and then nuke half your amber, which is pretty cool. So I think, you know, you look at Rant and Rive and you're like, yeah, there's a lot of ways to play around it. Is this going to be super impactful? But I'm kind of hot on it, not gonna lie, especially.
Oh, it's incredible, I think.
I mean, better or worse, do you think, than Cutthroat Research?
Much better. I think no
Oh,
question.
okay.
Cutthroat is pretty rare to actually like fire off and steal. It needs some good synergy, but what it cannot do by itself is take them off check. And Rant and Rive can do that up to 10. So I'll take Rant and Rive, I think, every day.
So I don't disagree with you. Rant and Rive can take you off check, but they'll both fire under the same conditions, right? Like they're both gonna fire at eight or more.
Yeah,
So
I think that's a difference maker though, to like take off check.
yeah.
Because so many times you're like, your opponent gets to eight and you have this amazing Logos hand, but all you can do is steal two and that's game. I mean, I'd much rather have that ability to take off check, especially if you're, you know, lining up some other potential synergies, even if it's not the third key. You know, like there are some things in Winds of Exchange that you can tax with. Like you were talking about, like what's the payoff for the Shattered Throne? Like in the Implacable Spirit Caller, you have the Cutthroats. In Winds of Exchange, you might have like a Faust, which could combo really well with Shattered Throne. You might have Mix the Tall Minded, which can tax for all the Mars creatures that you have out. So there are like more difficult ways to punish it. There's nothing as straightforward as like a graft or a TMTP, but there is some stuff. And with the increased focus on fighting in the Shattered Throne, Rant and Rive is another way to do it. Yeah, are we talking about Rant and Rive? Are we talking about Shattered Throne now? Rant and Rive is really an incredible card. No chains with it. It's like you think about what's that Brobnar action that we played a couple weeks ago that we both actually like, Power of Fire. Like we both have some interesting decks that we like with Power of Fire. This is just flat out better. You know, it only affects the opponent. It gives you a pip to start. You don't have to destroy a creature. You don't get any chains. Like this card is like, it's I think it's the only scaling Amber Control card in Winds of Exchange, if I'm not mistaken.
You could make an argument for what closed door negotiations, but it's a stretch. I think you might be right. You might be right. And I'm pretty hot on it too. So I wouldn't argue the point that, yeah, the bait and switch retrain.
It is like the bait and switch retrain. Yeah, there's Brobnar is definitely back, Dataforge Dream. And here's another reason why. It's like in Winds of Exchange, you have the scaling Amber Control with Brobnar. You have Burst with Brobnar with the Brick Nasty, which you can get in multiples. You have creature control just from the fighting and from a lot of actions out of hand that can deal three or four. They just have very powerful creatures. I think that this is like the house that's going to have the closest to having everything in the set, with maybe the exception being Equidon. Equidon does some really insane things, and it has efficiency, and it has artifact control. So those two houses are like really what I'm looking for every time I open a Winds of Exchange deck. And it's because of their versatility. Like, there's not many houses in the game from a single set that can provide you with some pretty good amber control and some burst and some creature control at the same time. Like, all of those things are pretty hard to come by, and Brobno does all three of them pretty well this set.
Cool. Yeah, not gonna disagree with you. I'm excited for it. Yeah, I've opened, I think, two Shattered Throne decks. I'm not playing one this evening, but definitely like its synergy with Rant and Rive. I think my I keep staring back to Rant and Rive. We have to change the name of the episode. I think my biggest gripe with Rant and Rive, my deck with two heavy subsidies has zero Rant and Rive. This is just unforgivable.
Well,
Unforgivable.
heavy subsidies is going to be a great topic for this podcast in the future, because we both love that card. I want to play some games with it first before I start to talk about it, because it seems like it's a pretty complex card. Shattered Throne, though, is one that a lot of us are familiar with, Autocannon as well. But we do have a new card that's Winds of Exchange exclusive that we're going to talk about. And I'm going to make the case that Ancient Battleground is a double-sided artifact.
I want to hear it, but first. I have a new semi-regular segment to introduce, Quick Draw. So if you don't mind, I want to just do that real quick.
I don't know what's coming. I'm very excited.
Yeah, and by semi-regular segment, I mean we're going to do it once and then
Stay sloppy.
forget. Yeah, this is we're making it official. We're calling it Billion Dollar Plans, $5 Blunders. Yeah.
We've been there.
We've been there, and this comes from a Moirai match, a Moirai League match. So the Swindle folks are running a Moirai League right now, which is super cool.
Are you going to call me out for this one, or did you make a similar mistake?
No, this is me. This one's all on
Oh,
me.
I'll talk about mine right after this then.
Okay. So I was playing against Linusu of the Nordic Keyforge podcast fame. And this was the reversal match, so I got to steal their Dark Depths, and
Dark Discovery.
Dark Discovery, Deep Dive,
Nope. Dive deep.
Dive Deep. Okay, Dive Deep's the one where you help me out here. You can
Oh,
tell
I
how
don't
many
remember
times
which.
I've played this one.
We can all see where this is going
You
now.
see where this is going. Yeah, this is exactly the card. Dive Deep. Okay. So I played Dive Deep on my first turn after their turn one. Okay. They played a Shadows creature their turn one. I played Dive Deep. Boom. Shadows. Easy, right? Tuck that card underneath. Their next turn, I mean, it might have been two turns later. Let's say their next turn, they threw out, three disc creatures. I'm like, all right, great enough, great enough. And then I go into Logos. Excuse me, Untamed, and play their Maverick, Think Twice, which is super cool, by the way. Maverick, Think Twice, awesome.
Wow.
Dive Deep again. They have only disc creatures in play. Of course, I flip a discard off the top,
Unbelievable.
and I'm looking at their disc creatures, and I'm like, oh, the Succubus, this other one looks pretty good. I'm like, I'm gonna take the Succubus. I write down Succubus. Okay, don't call the police on me. I was taking
Oh,
notes. Yeah.
you even took
I
notes.
even took notes. I have a piece sheet of paper with Succubus written on it, and then last minute I'm like, nah, I'm gonna take the Pit Demon.
Oh man.
Yep. And then like the next turn I
So we're
play.
talking turn three of this
This is
game.
like turn three, free key coming. I've already on check for my for a key from Amber. Should have a free key coming, and then I whiff. I whip on the dark. Depths, whip on the dark dust after punching in the name that I had written down. I'm like, oh, Succubus and Dodger, easy. And they flip over a Dodger Pit Demon.
My God.
And then
So, Did you win?
Well, instead of coasting to an easy, what would have been like easy 3-1, I lost 3-2.
Oh, man. That's I don't even know where to start with that one. You still don't know the name of the card. You played Dive Deep twice when you shouldn't have. Like I have a few Dark Discovery decks, and you want to hold that till they have a board. You want to hold that until like
I don't
if you're
disagree with
relying on
you.
that key. Yeah. And then you're just like, I'm gonna think twice it. I'm
It's just
gonna do
YOLO,
it
yeah.
again. Double down. I've opened two Unchained decks so far. The last one I opened is the most boring deck I've ever seen in my life, with 26 creatures, six angry mobs, a Phosphorus Stars with no Mars. It's the worst deck I've ever seen. But the other Unchained I opened is really sweet, and it actually has a Unfathomable Amphora Captura, and it has two Dark Discoveries, like with the full suite of two copies of each. Haven't played it yet. It's going to be a lot of fun, though. I have a much higher chance of hitting that Dark Discovery with two of them, so that's pretty cool. I like the segment. I'm going to share my own.
Okay.
And it was featuring also my Moirai match from this week, and also against none other than Fudginator in the chat. He knows exactly where I'm going with this. And it was the reversal, and I gave him my Evil Twin Chronophage deck, and I've played that a number of times. I know how tricky Chronophage can be. I've done it to other people. It's evil, and they like mess up, and they're like, "Oh crap, what did I just do?" Turns over, don't even think about it, and I'm like, "Tough luck, sucker." And then here I am playing this in reversal, and I'm looking at like my board of untamed creatures. One of them has Skirmish. Chronophage is out there, and I'm like, "All right, piece of cake. Just gonna fight it off. Play my two creatures. Play my Fangtooth Cavern. Get rid of their other card, Eddie, I think it was." And sure enough, what do? First action of the turn, raise the tide for whatever reason, and then play the Fangtooth Cavern without doing anything else. I literally drew no cards that turn. The Fangtooth did kill the Chronophage, at least that much.
Chelonia, Kill a Chelonia, if I remember right. You have to deal with
Oh,
it.
did it?
I don't want to say
I didn't
so.
even kill the creature that I wanted to kill. Maybe that's true. But I had a big enough board the next turn I could fight it anyway. But like, I had this huge turn already like planned out. I was like, this is great. I'm gonna wipe his board, get rid of the Chronophage, get rid of the Chelonia, and then all of a sudden my turn ended, and I was like, what happened? I was like looking around like, why can't I? Oh man. And then it was too late. Yeah, Fudginator says I did kill the Chelonia.
Fudginator
No, it
says
wasn't
you
my
killed
no,
your
it was not
Chelonia.
my Chelonia. No, I refute that. It was not my Chelonia. So, I mean, it's fitting. Like, it fits the segment if it was my Chelonia. It fits the segment if it wasn't my Chelonia. I don't think it
Would
was.
have
But
been an evil Chelonia.
I think it was the evil Chelonia, yeah.
Okay, so then it
Which
was
I guess
probably
in reversal game, he's not wrong. It was my Chelonia. I just let him play with it that game.
okay. Yep,
So.
the reversal, your Chelonia. Okay, fair enough.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Okay. Well, I think I'm good for one of these every week, if not every 2 weeks. So,
Yeah, you're definitely good for these. I watch a lot of your games, and
my
I still
gosh.
will never forget the time that you were streaming a game and you said, control the weak, and you're like, I'm going to call dis, and then you just clicked Sanctum or something like that. I was like, what are you doing? And sure enough, he has like a handful of Sanctum, and he's like, okay.
Yeah, that was too funny. Just unloads the hand, and I'm like there scratching my head, like, wait, how are you playing all these cards that I controlled the weak you out of? What's going on?
Oh, we gotta find that clip. It's on our channel somewhere, and we gotta find that clip. Your look of confusion was just epic.
So there you have it. $1 billion plan, $5 blunders. I like it. I like
Yeah.
it.
Some self-deprecating humor.
There you
If you
go.
can't laugh at yourself, what are you gonna do?
Laugh with the people in the chat who are laughing at you.
Yes. That's the next best thing.
Yeah, indeed. Cool. All right, well, we have to play the music to get back to the main segments.
Yeah. Sloppy, no audio effects, no intro outro music. So we're back to talking about double-sided artifacts. And this one, as I said before, I'm going to make the case for this being double-sided. And we're talking about Ancient Battleground. If you could pull up Ancient Battleground on the stream, when this card was spoiled, I was like, this card is insane. I thought it was like, this card is so good. I can't wait to play with this. Everyone wants to fight. It says each friendly creature cannot reap and gains after fight, gain one. Now, it is just friendly, so it does not apply to your opponents. You're probably thinking this is not a double-sided artifact. But if your opponent plays an Ancient Battleground and they have no way of getting rid of it, you, as the opponent, have to strongly consider discarding every creature for the rest of the game. And that's why I think this is a potential double-sided artifact. I got to play a Winds of Exchange game against this probably a couple weeks ago with one of my locals. We had some decks. He got his package in, and I had a few leftover decks from from KFC that I got from other people. And I had a Whirlpool deck, of course, and he had the Ancient Battleground out, and he had a bunch of Mars tokens. He had a huge board. He had some Grovnar creatures. And then it dawned on me after like two turns, I was like, I don't need to play any creatures ever. And I had just enough like capture pips with the Whirlpool and amber pips to just play some things out of hand. And I just stopped playing creatures. And he would pass me someone, hoping that I would play someone else that he could fight it. And I just kept passing it, and he wasn't allowed to reap. So this card went from like after that game, this card went for me from being like a really insane, great, strong card in Bravnar to like you might have to discard this a lot. And it's going to take some good evaluation of decks when you're about to play this to think like, can I win this game if they just immediately discard every creature from here out?
Yeah, worth noting that this is not Pester Grove. Like, your creatures are not enraged. They don't get to reap if there's nothing to fight. If there's nothing to fight, you still cannot reap. You just cannot reap. So yeah, a note from the chat, like, it's the new Quixel. Like, that was 100% gonna be my point. Like, this might just be the new Quixel Stone. I think Quixel Stone in Brobnar is a little awkward in Winds of Exchange, you know?
Yeah.
The deck that I've pulled up here, I think, has nine Brobnar creatures. One, two, three, nine and change. Looks like nine. So I don't know. I think that there is a double-sided, yeah, incentive, or I guess it has a double-sided effect, which is to make no reaping happen for pretty much everybody, but because your opponent's not playing creatures and you're sitting there with a whole big old board. Now,
Yeah.
It doesn't say you must fight, it just says you cannot reap, which is also interesting, right? So, if you have things like Mesmerist, Yixlix Mesmerist, you can still action it. If you this deck happens to have a bot token, so you can still action the bot. And then I guess fight with something else or action something else.
Yeah. Still can't reap.
Still can't
And
reap.
the Mesmerist is an action. I think an enemy creature captures one from its own side. So like, if they don't have any creatures out because they're discarding them, then he's a little less good. One. So I do have one Ancient Battleground deck, and it has the Traitor token, which is an action: steal one, destroy itself. So that's actually a pretty good card to have with the Ancient Battleground because you don't need to reap to make money. You can at least do the action, destroy itself. So you at least have that backup plan going for it. The other backup plan that I would recommend with it is some kind of artifact control. And my Ancient Battleground deck also happens to have Celestial Gorm. So if there's ever a time when they're just discarding creatures and I have a huge board of Brobnar that can't do anything, I can at least pop the Celestial Gorm as an Omni, return the Ancient Battleground to my hand, reap out. So that's a good backup plan to have as well. If you don't have that kind of backup plan, though, I think you really need to think about like, how many pips do I have in my deck, and how many do they have in their deck? Can I win a game where we are just playing action pips and nothing else? You can play your creatures, and if they have a pip, great. But if they don't have an action to gain amber, if you're like relying on reaping, you're probably not going to win that game if your opponent recognizes that and just discards and goes by their ability to just play actions from there out.
Yep, totally. So, funnily enough, the deck that I've pulled up, the deck that I'm probably going to play in our game later, Garland, the Groen's Wing Leader, does feature Ancient Battleground, and it also has a Quixel Stone. It's kind of some nice poetry there. The Starlines getting on board with the plan and only having, I think, three creatures, but yeah, the Brobnar having a full nine. So,
Yeah, let me reevaluate the deck I'm going to play and make sure it has artifact control now.
Getting quick draw nervous over there.
It does not, so
You don't need artifact control. You just need lots of pips. Just need lots of pips. Yeah.
All right. I think I'm good then. Yeah, I think we're good.
Yeah. Yeah, I unfortunately don't know if I have enough pips to be doing that. So we'll see.
We will see. I have a Shadow Throne deck that I'm going to play. So I'm all about the fighting. I'm not planning on getting sweaty and just discarding all my creatures against you in the episode where we're talking about Brobnar fighting. So
that's good, because I would have to call you a coward and it would get awkward.
And you would be correct. Fast forward 30 minutes and you're screaming at me, calling me a coward. And I'm like, creatures. Well, at least I won. And you have the Quixel Stone, which we talked about earlier for whatever random reason, but we have tokens now, so you can get around the Quixel Stone. So I'm less afraid of the Quixel Stone than I was before Winds of Exchange.
Mm-hmm. And I think also for this deck, I mean, I'm probably happy for you to be going ahead and on board with tokens. I'll play my dudes. I'll play my Brick Dastnys if you want your tokens. Like, that's fine. Yeah. I think I'm probably still discarding the Quixel, though. I don't know. I have yet to play this deck, so we're going to find it. Maybe we'll just play all the cards and see what happens, you know?
That's what I like to do when a new set comes out. And we can, you know, I feel like this is relevant now, too, is, you know, I don't worry so much about, like, is this a good card? Should I play this in this matchup? If it's the first time I'm playing with a new set, play it. See what happens. Like, what's the worst that could happen? Like, the card does terrible for you and you lose the game. And then you earn that. But if you just discard it, then you're not going to learn anything about it.
Not going to learn anything about that. Right on. Well, cool. I don't know. What else do we have to say about Ancient Battleground? Any nuggets? Any nuggets tucked away up there?
I'm excited to play it more. I do think that it is a heavy drawback. And I think that there's definitely going to be cases where you don't want to play this. As strong as this fight effect is, like, it's definitely going to be a discard in a lot of decks and a lot of matchups. Mm-hmm. But it's a really cool card. I guess I'm kind of glad it's rare, because it's probably going to be, I'm going to guess it's dead more often than not, but it is a really cool card to have the chance to play when you get it. So I'm pretty excited about it. Who are the creatures featured in the art of that card?
I was just going to ask you, what the heck are those creatures?
Are they little prospectors?
I don't know.
I have no idea. The Cloggin, do you want to spoil this for us? I don't know what those are. What does the lore say? Well, we say ancient, that the battle was ongoing as of last week.
Ooh, they look like little demony things. I don't know. Looks fun.
Yeah, well, maybe the Cloggin will spoil it for us and we'll share it. I have no idea what those are. Work for it, maybe for next episode. All right, that's fair. Tune in next week when we find out what creatures are on Ancient Battleground.
Okay, cool.
We got the hook.
Oh, Quixel Stone's Freelancer. Yeah. Yeah.
What's
some
Freelancer?
Some cool. Cool stuff going on. At the start of each player's turn, the active player takes control of this creature. It's kind of like the one card whirlpool. This creature may be used as if it belongs to the house. Yeah.
I love it. Yeah, that's just like the Quixel Stone Whirlpool interaction, but the tokens change the math on it. But that's really cool. That's rare right there.
That's rare. I mean, and yet to be seen too, because I mean, I'm looking over this deck, it does seem like a lot of actions making tokens, but there are plenty of creatures that make tokens as play effects or as reap effects. So we'll see. I think folks are being very quick to write off Quixel in this new world, but I don't know. I think it's maybe going to take a slightly new twist, but I think it's still going to be very much a force. So we'll see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Cool.
All right. Well, we're going to get to a game in a minute, but we have a word from a sponsor first.
Oh, we do indeed. So this episode of Bottom of the Beaker was brought to you by E on the Fringes School of Dance. Whether it's boogie or disco, with E on the Fringes, it'll never be you on the fringes. So thank you very much, E on the Fringes School of Dance. I appreciate your support for the game and the show. And Bottom of the Beaker is recorded Tuesdays at 9:30 Eastern right here at twitch.tv/sloppylapark. You could find recordings of our past shows and archives of other streams over on YouTube. Search for @sloppylapark there. For the very best content. 34? No, 57 times distilled, and then scrape from the bottom of the beaker. Search for that very phrase in your podcatcher of choice, and you'll find us there, ready to fight, capture amber, and maybe ping you for one. I don't know. All those things. Find all that and more over at sloppylabwork.com. And yeah, quick draw. Do you have anything else to say to the folks getting off the last audio stop?
Just stay sloppy and keep on fighting.
Nice. Keep on fighting. Well, let's see if them's fighting words. So we're going to head on over to the old Crucible, or the new Crucible.
Wait, how are we going to play this game? How are we going to play with these? We talked about these Winds of Exchange decks.
Yeah. We're going to play on the dev server. The dev server.
How about that? So by the time you're listening on the podcast, everyone will have access anyway. And this won't even be a big deal. But we're excited.
We're excited. Cool. So I've already got my deck loaded up. I should probably say for the clogging, like, star heart, favorite, subscribe, thumb it up. That's how people find out about the show. And that's how we know that you like it. And so, yeah, here we over are on the dev side of the Crucible. Quick Draw's got a game in beginner. Very appropriate.
All these $5 blunders.
All these $5 blunders. Cool. All right, got my deck loaded up. I'm more of a sadist than hate the client.
All right, so one thing that I noticed earlier is the token is listed currently, like, in the right in the middle of the deck list. It's not listed on the bottom. It is a bug that they are fixing. So you'll notice if you go check it out, there's like 13 cards listed under Star Alliance for yours, and then 13 for under Unfathomable for mine. So a little weird, but I'm actually playing my namesake deck tonight. This is one of my three namesake decks that has a Shattered Throne. And the token is the Priest from Unfathomable.
Cool. Looks sweet. Yeah, I see some of those guys there. I am playing the one that I showed before. It's got Ancient Battleground and Quixel Stone. I'll probably play them both. We'll see. I'm going to make this a little bit bigger. But cool. All right. A little bit of a funky hand. Let's mulligan, see what we get.
I like this one. And let's play out a Krog the Clumsy.
Ooh, spicy.
Start the fighting early.
All right, I'm going to move some Mars. I'm going to play a Suspended Animation to do a damage there, and then tuck him into the old archives. Kind of nice how that pip worked out.
That's a good card.
Yeah.
Oh, that is a very good pip, how that works out.
Yeah.
No wonder that card seems good. I didn't think that card was that good.
It's not that good, usually. But, I mean, it's still fine.
All right, I got some more big boys for you. And I've got a Brick Nasty.
My goodness. Oh, dear. Oh, dear. Well, I guess I could give you some fighting fodder. That seems not cool. Oof. Oof, oof, Quick Draw.
You afraid of Brobnar?
I kind of am. I'm going to go Star Alliance. Play the old teamwork, make a bot. And then the SV3 lander to make another bot.
All right. A couple bots, not bad. I will go with the Unfathomable. Let's put out an Extrematode Infection, and I don't particularly like this card, but I'll put it on your bigger creature here. Play out the Ghost Fin with a damage pip to get rid of one of those bots. And then I am going to play the Initiation to make a token creature. Oh, the Priest is a 2-power. I thought the Priest was a 1-power. I'll take it.
Oh, weird.
A little UI thing here. If you put your hover your mouse over your token, it will tell you the underlying card.
Yeah, and it shows me the back of your card as opposed to.
Okay. Yeah, I noticed the same thing. I thought that was a bug, but maybe that is what it's supposed to do. And you hover over it and it's going to show me the token. So,
Yep, I see the priest.
all right, now a super cool card here. Love this card, Abyssal Sight. Destroy a creature, friendly creature, and then I can look at your hand and choose a card and make you discard it.
That's pretty cool.
So I am very into that right now. I'm going to destroy my priest. You have a very nice Brobnar hand here. Pingle Who Annoys would be one to consider if the priest were a one power. You got a Krog the Clumsy with a damage pip. You've got an Earthshaker. I kind of want to get rid of a big creature, I think.
My
So,
dudes.
yeah, your dude. So let's do the Krog. I'm gonna get rid of the Krog. Think I'm cool with that. Yeah, let you kill
What
your own bot
a
here.
jerk.
Yeah.
Oh my. So you're removing counters from this extreme Trematode infection, huh?
Yeah. We'll see how long that guy survives. Yeah,
Yeah.
that's why the Extrematode is really slow to make three tokens, and it's probably never going to trigger.
Interesting.
I could
Interesting.
have put it on my own. If I put it on my own Krog, maybe it would have had more chance to survive, but tough to say.
Tough to say. Awkward. All right, I'm gonna move some of this Brobnar now. Ugh.
Did I pick the right card?
I mean, they were all pretty solid, I guess. I don't hate that choice. I think it was pretty good. Was not one that you were going to be fighting and do profitably, so that's pretty cool. Pingle Who Annoys. It's kind of annoying that it gives you elusive guy to fight too, and you're not really punished for it.
Pingle is very similar to the autocannon we talked about, except it's
Yeah,
one-sided.
very
So,
similar. Okay. Tossing this guy out. Damage there. And yeah, I'll play the Pingle. Okay.
okay.
Cool.
All right. Let's see what we got here. I could gain three from fights if I wanted, or I can play a handful of Saurian. Think I'm gonna go with a handful of Saurian.
That's a
And on
thing.
top of that, I think I'm gonna. Yeah, it's a tough call. Do I think maybe I just kill the Pingle? Really want to get rid of that Earthshaker too.
Lot of choices, my guy.
All right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to start with the Praetor, which is not a great card. Man, some of these Saurian cards, I just don't understand the logic of the designs. Like, yeah, I don't think he's ever gonna come in handy. All right, so I got four now. Let's Phalanx Strike the Pingle, and
Cool.
I don't think I am. Yeah, actually, let's exalt and deal a bunch to the Fire Spitter. And then we're going to Beware the Ides to get rid of your big boy. And Top Flight Story on the
Oof.
Fire Spitter, and then the Pax Sariana to ward everything.
Ooh, nice.
That's a good card. I'm pretty pleased with that in this moment. I've played it twice since the set came out, and I'm 2 for 2 with liking it.
Yeah, I don't hate it. I definitely don't hate it. That changes some things for me.
Tell you what I like is I have another deck with the Pax Sariana, and I can follow it up with a Numquid the Fair the next turn. It's a
Yep.
pretty cool combo.
I also don't like having my weaponsmith warded. It feels awkward.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. I was like, I'm actually not sad about that one.
All right, playing out some dudes. Throw down my own Brick Nasty. The Fire Spitter is before fight. It is gonna do a decent job of cracking your wards, which is nice. I'll fight into Brick Nasty and smash it. And that's it for the moment. That's it for the moment.
Okay. See, the fighting is already coming into play. That's a good fight. Good before fight effect.
Totally.
Think I am, well, I don't have my before fight benefit anymore, but I think I do want to use my creature control here with Robnar.
Yeah, you gotta get rid of this weaponsmith, man. That's like it's bearing down on you.
Yeah, he's tough. Unfortunately, I think I might actually pop his ward.
Okay.
Maybe I don't have to actually. So what we are gonna do is, I want to get rid of your Brick Nasty. For sure. I'm gonna play out a Pelf. And then I'm gonna Berserker Slam, but do I want a Berserker Slam first? Why are there still two tokens on the Weaponsmith? Shouldn't there be one? Two counters?
So on,
Maybe that was the first time.
you played it on turn, let's see.
Three.
You played it on turn
Turn
3.
four, I removed one. Hopefully that's just a UI bug. I have removed two from it, so there should only be one on there. Are you seeing the same thing as I am?
It's showing a 2, but I also wasn't seeing any. Let's see.
Yeah. Well, we're gonna manual mode that one because I want my extreme toad infection to actually pay off for me here. All right, we're gonna Berserker Slam the Fire Spitter. We're gonna have Krog bite into Brick Nasty, and then I am going to just reap with the Fire Spitter.
Interesting. 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 Okay. Oh boy. Super awkward. You know what? I'm gonna go. Yeah, Brobnar here. Play Breck Nasty number 2.
That's a good one.
Fight this dude. Fight this dude. Getting all the fights in. Melander or no lander? What a question. I think no lander. Unfortunately.
Oh yeah, I triggered it. All right, it's working.
Oh,
It's
it's
just
doing stuff.
it's doing stuff. It should pop your ward, which it did not. Do you still see the ward?
I still see the ward in the 2. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what the two's going on there, but let's remove that ward. There we go. Now we're good. Beautiful. All right, this is going to be a big one. So let's see what I got under here.
And hang on a second. Make 3 token creatures. Okay, so they should be exhausted tokens, right?
They are exhausted. They're showing exhausted for me.
Oh, okay.
Are they showing ready for you?
They're showing ready for me, although it might be a quirk of the like half card display that I've got.
I think so. So they are definitely exhausted. I will not be using my priest here, unfortunately. Really wish I could. I actually don't love the cards that are under them either, so I kind of just wish I could kill them somehow. Oh, I wish I could play this Maelstrom, but I think that's a bad idea. So I'm not going to. I'm going to discard the Maelstrom.
It's not a Maelstrom episode, so you can discard it without shame.
Yeah. I am going to bubbles, and I'm going to get rid of...
Oof.
I don't want you to go back to Brovnar. And you'll see why in a second.
Okay. Okay.
So I'm gonna pop the Brick Nasty. I am going to play a sunk cost. And I get to name a house. And you discard a random card. And if it belongs to the chosen house, I make a token creature. I haven't seen any Star Alliance yet, except for the Lander. So I've got to think you have a lot of Star Alliance.
Maybe.
And it's the Brovnar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 Brovnar I've seen so far. Okay, well, you discarded it at least. Let's play the Bryozoark. Make you work through those tokens.
Oh my.
All right.
Oh my.
I like that.
Well, that's awkward.
See how good this card is.
Super awkward. Huh. Okay, now we're thinking. We were not thinking before, but now we've started thinking.
I wonder how many creature play effects there are to deal damage this set. Like ways to get rid of that Bryozoark.
From hand.
Yeah,
it's a good question.
The bubbles will do it, but you don't have the bubbles.
Bubbles will do it. The downgraded or upgraded, depending on your perspective, Ganger Chieftain will do it.
Oh, the Rowdy Scald. No, yep. Not Rowdy Scald.
Rowdy Scald is the one with all the enhancements.
What's he called?
Shock Herder, maybe? Something like that?
Yeah, Shock Herder. That's it. That's a good card. Very good card.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think of that, actually, about it being like a different Ganger Chieftain. That is a good point.
Yeah, with Deploy. I think the -2 power is a decent trade-off for the Deploy. Wow,
minus
this is
3 power, I think, isn't it?
I think it's... Is it a 2 or a 3? I'll have to double check.
It's a 2.
Oof, awkward. Okay, I'm going to move some cards here. Smash a thing, but I still get a damage pip, which is cool. Smash another thing. Play this Duder. Okay.
All right. So you get to check.
Get to check.
Ooh, interesting. I do have one way to take you off check, which might be worth it. I don't know what my follow-up is in future turns. It's not often worth it to take off check for the first key just for the sake of taking off check.
Yeah.
Could have a pretty good turn here, but I would open up a chance for you to kill the Bryozoark, which I don't want to do. I also kind of am tempted to use the board while I can.
Decision time.
Yeah, it is. I know you have the Brick Nasty back. 10. So you've got two other Brobnar cards somewhere. You've got the Ancient Battleground somewhere. And you've got a Volca, which I don't even know what Volca does.
Volca's the splash attack. From
Oh,
the
each other Brobnar gains splash attack. Strong card. Very good card. All right, I think I am going to I think I'm going to cycle and let you take an opportunity to kill the Bryozoark. But you're going to have to go Brobnar to do it. So we're going to beware the Ides on the Mars creature. We are going to Legionary Trainer, put in a ready token on the left, Phalanx Leader,
Cool.
another token on the left,
Oof.
and a Longusor Lector also on the left. And you have a Kaboom, which you can play in two turns, so I'm not going to exalt him. I think that would be getting a little greedy. That's all I got.
Okay, that's a key. Oof, awkward.
Yeah. Those Kabooms probably burning a hole in your archives right now.
You
Actually,
know?
those are that's the my creature in your archives.
Yeah, I think I have to just go for it. And kill that Bryozoark. I was for a time thinking I didn't mind having it around. But oof. Okay. Anyway, gotta do it. Let's smash this Bryozoark. Ooh, did I miss that?
Did it not let you trigger the friendly guide?
It didn't.
Okay.
I should be able to, right? It feels like.
You can definitely use it, yeah. So we can just move these guys to the discard
Okay, cool. So that's
if you want to
definitely
fight with it.
yeah, it's
Yeah.
fight into the Bryozoark.
That's what I figured your line would be.
Cool. And sad turn.
Yeah.
Sad turn.
I'm cool with that. I mean, I'm sure we have a Kaboom incoming. So, I think I'm just going to have to take advantage of the board while I have it. Really good token card right there. definitely adds some complexity when you're trying to figure out what how you can get these cards back that are tokens.
And you're about to reshuffle.
I am. We'll take the archives there. I think I'm just gonna reap. And then I'm actually going to Adult Swim my own tokens,
Cool.
which is also going to send back the Legionary Trainer, unfortunately, because I'm going to make a token. And I wish it came in ready. Okay, I did not tokenize the card that I wanted. I just drew the card I wanted, so I'm good. And I check at 11.
Interesting. Yeah, that befuddle is going to be problematic.
That's the card I was tokenized that I was looking for.
Yeah. Priest is
It's a
two
really
power
good
and a
card.
whimper.
Befuddle, better or worse than Mark of Dis?
I have to remind myself on the wording. They can't play cards of the chosen house. Is that the one?
I choose a house on your opponent's identity card. During their next turn, they cannot play cards of other houses.
Of other
So I
houses.
basically, you can only play cards of the house that I name.
Interesting. That would be a good question. I'm not sure if I have a.
I think I'm going to say it's better than Mark.
Wow, that's bold. I do have a double
Just,
befuddle, double.
yeah. There's no way to play around it. You can't prepare for it.
Oof, trouble. There's a case to be made for going Star Alliance, making a couple tokens. Reap for two is just really good, though. That's sad. Okay, so we're going Mars. Do I want you in my archives? That's a good question. Think I do. But the befuddle's problematic either way. Think I want you in my archives, though. Okay.
There's those kabooms. I do have the kaboom.
Yeah.
The chains hurt, but I think it's a great card.
Oh.
Any reason that you
Oh no, I was just
hopped a lander?
thinking it was a different card.
Well, I'm pretty sure I'm safe here.
Yep, do your
Two,
worst.
three, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. I really wish I could play the Shattered Throne that's in my hand now, but I'm gonna get sweaty and just play a befuddle and say you cannot play cards of other houses, so let's go Brobnar. Do your worst with Brobnar.
But didn't want to give me a creature, for the
No, I didn't have any, but also no, I did not want to give you one. It's the bot is no, you could at least call Star, use the bot, or you could just call Mars.
Would have been nice though, you know. Well, I am gonna show my true class and finish the game with an ancient battleground on the table.
Excellent choice. Good game.
Good game, well played.
Yeah, I wish we could have got one of those artifacts out sooner. Does your deck, do you think it wants to play the Ancient Battleground?
I'm not sure many decks do.
Yeah. Well, the Double Brick Nasty is really good with it.
It
So
is. So
it
if,
drastically would change my game plan.
yeah, I mean, if you're committed to making a board as well, then I would absolutely love to have it. Like, totally. I mean, the mesmerists are great still. The bots can enable the mesmerist or allow me to fight with my Brobnar dudes. Like, pretty happy for all of that.
I got a question, something we didn't get to on the podcast tonight was, does the Ancient Battleground make board wipes like Kaboom worse? Or do you, I mean, you just probably like, it's probably a factor and you just wouldn't play the Battleground.
Interesting. Does it make it worse? So if I already have a board, it's interesting in that if I'm playing Ancient Battleground, if I've played Ancient Battleground, you're not playing your creatures, right? But I'm already ahead, so I guess that doesn't really matter. If I've fallen behind, if I've fallen behind, am I even going to play the Ancient Battleground then? Probably, because I'm fighting to get back to parity. So that feels like better. Like, I can still make amber while fighting. And then I play a board wipe when I get it to kind of reset, and now my prospects are looking grim, because you're like, find no more creatures, right? I don't know.
It changes the math a little bit, I think.
Yeah, I mean, if you have, I'm trying to think of when you'd have a deck that's like happy to push your opponent off from playing creatures. So maybe you have, lots of pips yourself, or profitable actions. But it's almost like, I mean, a board wipe is great in a Quixel deck, right? Because you find your Quixel late and you want to now say, okay, we're going to reset the board and start playing my game, right? I don't know if it's as good here. I want to say no. Yeah, I don't know if.
You don't think the wipes are as good here, you think?
I don't think they're, well, I'm trying to think of what a Ancient Battleground deck would look like, that really wants to one like lean into the fighting, but then also be happy if you don't play any creatures. And I'm like having a hard time imagining that deck and then how the
I mean, I could
board wipes
say
play
that.
in.
Let me link you to the deck that I have that I feel is kind of in there. It is purposely Amorphous Alinar. I'll drop it in the chat here as well. It is, like I mentioned before, it has the Celestial Gorm so that it can turn it off whenever I want. It also has the Traitor token, which is a way to use my board to get some amber if I'm not reaping. I do feel like this is a pretty good Ancient Battleground deck. I just wish that it had more Brobnar creatures. It has no Brick Nasty. It only has five Brobnar creatures and no Brobnar token. So, in that regard, it's not great. But you have other things like the Battlefield Evangelist that wants to fight. The Martyr of the Vault probably wants to fight. Belligerent Guard wants to fight. So, it has a bit going for it. I could see it being a situational play in this deck. Whereas in other decks, it could just be like an always a discard. At least in here, I think there's a lot of situations where I could play it.
Yeah, I like that you have the Celestial Gorm to
Yeah.
reset as well. Because I mean, I think having something like that or an auction off just as like a okay, we're gonna play this out, roll with it till it's not profitable any longer, and then kind of switch back. is just a lot to commit to no reaping for the rest of the game if your plan revolves around playing lots of creatures, you know? Yeah, in Data Forge stream saying, yeah, like there's a case to be made for like the late rush, you know, where you're making one final push. This is my last stand. It's tough. It's tough because you're saying, you know, my big push involves throwing out a lot of dudes, probably fighting off your board, and then having nothing to do with my creatures once I fought off your board.
There's a lot of like not quite calculus, but at least some light math involved. If you think about how much can I make from fighting and clearing the board, and then how do I have enough to get me across the finish line before them? Like you might be able to survive with fewer pips if you have a big enough lead.
Yeah, and I mean, I think it's gonna pair well. Almost a shame we didn't really put it together for the discussion part. But like, you want cards in your deck that's going to really encourage your opponent to get their own creatures down to fight, right? Like, especially in Winds of Exchange where maybe the board control options are a little bit thinner on the ground, right? Like, so if you're playing Timoti, of the Damned, I mean, I'm just gonna keep throwing out these witches, and if you don't have enough board control from hand, then probably I am playing Ancient Battleground because your only path to clearing them out is your own creatures, right? So it was interesting, yeah.
And the Bryozoark is another witch that you could hide behind with an Ancient Battleground, but that's a crosshouse double rare, so unlikely to see that very often.
Yeah, I don't hate that, and especially, I mean, maybe there's a really interesting kind of Brobnar Unfathomable deck that even features either Berserker or the poison or the Unfathomable token with poison that wants to get in there and fight, remove a dude, gain amber. I don't know.
Sometimes has poison.
So, has poison when fighting, yeah, on your
Only
side.
when you fight with it, like during your turn.
During your turn, yeah.
They can just fight into it and it's just a nothing.
It's just nothing. So we're grasping, trying to give that guy the Raider. Is that the Raider? Yeah.
Raider, yeah. Excellent art. 10 out of 10 art. Probably the bottom tier token.
A bottom tier token. I mean, if we're you know, raiding free creatures from thin air.
Well, hey, Floxamol did a token tier rating show a couple days ago. Check out his channel. I don't know if he's watching tonight. I also don't know the address of his channel, so hopefully you can find Floxamol. Oh, it is just Floxam underscore all. There we go. It's right under my followed channel. It's very easy to find.
Yeah, I think they put Berserker and a couple others in their top tier.
Prospector.
Prospector and maybe one other. I'm
I think
blanking.
Bellatorian Warrior.
Cool.
Yeah. So yeah, we're checking out. It's a good way to familiarize yourself with the tokens.
Totally. And that was cool. That was, I mean, some rough edges, but I don't know. I'd definitely rather get the Winds of Exchange out there for prime time on TCO and let folks play with it and tamp stuff down later.
Yeah, it's great that it's almost there. Huge shout out and props to everyone that's worked on it. That is certainly not me. I am a project manager, not a developer. I just like to ask all the hard questions of the smart people and wait for them to get the job done. So I've heard it's soon. According to the TCO Discord server, it's coming soon.
Yeah, coming together really soon. I was poking at some cards for a while, and then it got to a point where there were no cards left. It's like, oh, all right, sweet. So I think
Yeah.
it's looking
Because we
good.
saw like there's just a few quality of life improvements that could have happened, but totally functional, easily fixable, just well worth it.
Totally. Cool. Well,
All
ooh,
right.
Rebel has top tier potential. I like that. That might be a take for a t-shirt and see if it makes you rich. I don't hate Rebel. Top tier.
I don't know about top tier. I don't hate Rebel either. I think it's also one power, right? We didn't even mention it when talking about the autocannon tonight, but that's a pretty sad token versus an autocannon.
Yeah, and can do a lot of work. Can be board control while reaping, which is not to be overlooked. So definitely can do some work.
And combos very well with, I think it's Zyzok.
That's Sizo. He runs the Nordic Keyforge League.
No. I'm telling you, I think I got the name right. Nope, I did not. Who's the Mars creature with splash and skirmish?
Oh, yeah, I know the one you mean. I know the one you mean, but if you're looking for a name, I got nothing.
I'm gonna find it. I
Three
have a
power,
really.
splash one, skirmish, readies when it kills a thing with its splash damage.
Yeah, which is a really cool card. I've come close to rule of sixing him in some games before.
Cool.
He's a very good card, I think. I'm just gonna keep talking and delaying until I find his name because it's killing me now. It's gotta be in one of these decks. Zyzok. It is Zyzok. Yeah.
There you
Zyzok. I was right. Yeah. Ketzer
Zyzok.
got it at the same time.
Nice, Ketzer. Thank you.
Yeah, very, very good card. And with the rebel to kind of like ping and prepare your splash to kill something, it can do pretty well.
Yeah, really cool. And with the rebel that readies, Yixlex Rebel maybe is the name. I'm blanking also, but
I think
well.
you played it that game.
I did, and then archived it, and then had double Yixlex Rebel and Mesmerus ready to go to capture your amber if you gave me a deuter. But
Well, you
womp
decided
womp
to kaboom my creatures, so it's
womp. You
on you.
know, it was on me one way or another. But anyway, good game, fun
Yeah,
times. Thanks
great
for
game.
folks in the chat hanging out. Appreciate y'all hanging with us, and we're gonna sign off and catch y'all around the lab.
Yeah, enjoy the Winds of Exchange as soon as you can.
Later, peeps. Bye.